Welcome everyone to our second workshop, Community-Based Programming, Key Concepts and Practices. My name is Adil Mirab, and please know that this session is being recorded and will be available on the OCASI website early next week. And we will send an email informing you of that. The presentation today, as well as additional tools and resources, are available right now to download from the project webpage. In case you'd like to have them on the side while today's session, or if you'd like to review them after today. Next slide, please. First, we would like to mention a few housekeeping and engagement and self-care points for this session. OCASI is committed to supporting full participation and engagement by all attendees at our events, including people with disabilities. This session is facilitated in English. However, French Simultaneous Interpretation, American Sign Language, ASL, and LSQ and English captioning are available. If you'd like to use the French Simultaneous Interpretation, in your meeting control toolbar at the bottom of your Zoom screen, you can click on the interpretation icon and then click on French. You also have the option to hear the interpreted language only. You can click on mute original audio. And if you wish to turn on the ASL or the LSQ feature, at the same interpretation icon, click on it. And then under watch, you can click on ASL for American Sign Language or French Sign Language for LSQ. Second slide, please. If you wish to enable closed captions, next to the interpretation feature at the bottom of your Zoom screen, you will see CC for captions. And finally, if we would kindly ask of you to share with us your thoughts and your questions on Slido, you can click on Slido and use the code you see here, or you can click on the link which is posted in the chat box, or you can also scan the QR code with your phone if you prefer to access Slido from your phone. We're just going to give 10 seconds if anyone would like to scan it. Thank you. We will also please feel free to ask about any of those features in the chat box. We will also provide those links again if needed. Next slide, please. Okay, housekeeping and self-care. Zoom fatigue is real. So do what you need to do to take care of you first. Stay present and be attentive to your body and your emotions. This session will be recorded and uploaded to the project site. And finally, please fill out the evaluation form that we will be sharing at the end of this session to help us improve our future workshops. Second slide, please. And now I would like to read the land acknowledgement. I would like to begin by acknowledging the traditional territories of the peoples of Turtle Island. The sacred land on which we are gathered today has been a site of human activity for 15,000 years. We acknowledge the land OCASI is situated on, which is the traditional territory of many nations, including the Mississaugas of the Credit, the Anishinaabe, the Chippewa, the Haudenosaunee, and the Wendat peoples, and is now home to many diverse First Nations, Inuit, and Métis peoples. This territory was the subject of the Dish with One Spoon, One Palm Belt Covenant, an agreement between the Haudenosaunee and the Ojibwe and allied nations to peacefully share and care for the resources around the Great Lakes. We also acknowledge that Toronto is covered by Treaty 13 with the Mississaugas of the Credit. Next slide, please. Okay. And now I would like to briefly introduce our trainers for today's session. Zubeida Ramji is a Toronto-based consultant in the not-for-profit sector with extensive planning, evaluation, and organizational development expertise in community-based health and social service agencies. She brings a strong community-based philosophy to her work, as well as a firm grasp on issues related to access to services for marginalized groups, including women, refugees, new immigrants, and ethno-racial communities. Zubeida has worked in diverse settings in Canada and in developing countries, where professionals, volunteers, and consumers have been jointly involved. And our second trainer for today is Amy Goh. Amy is also a Toronto-based consultant in the not-for-profit sector. Amy is a social worker by training. She started her career as a manager of immigrant services and community development at Wood Green Community Center and became the director of community support services at Wood Green. From 18 years, Amy was the executive director of Yihong Center for Geriatric Care. Amy is also an advocate and has taken leadership roles in many local, provincial, and national organizations promoting human rights, social justice, and equity. Thank you. Zubeida and Amy, whenever you're ready.
Thank you so much for that introduction, Adil. And welcome everyone to this workshop on community-based programming. Amy and I are delighted to be here as your resource. We have several years of experience, but I must say that we continue to learn because communities are evolving and everything around us, including the funding environment that we're in, continues to evolve. So we are looking forward to learning with you today, as well as in the follow-up session next week. We are going to aim to initially in this workshop review some what we think are some key concepts and guiding principles for community-based programming. And then we'll get into some more of the detailed understanding around developing and presenting a program concept to potential funders to make it make your proposals compelling proposals to be funded. So that's what our overall aim is. Next slide, please. We've divided up the time that we have available. It is an ambitious agenda that we have. So we will kind of try to move through this very quickly. We hope that, you know, we get to some questions and answers today, but we're also quite feeling reassured that there is an opportunity again next week to address some of the areas that we may have to go over quickly. And we're really excited about the follow-up session because our experience is, and I think most of you will agree, that sometimes, you know, you are on information overload and it takes time to digest some of the materials. So to come up with some meaningful questions and understanding that follow-up session hopefully will be really helpful. Next slide, please. So I'm going to go over the first few slides and which cover the concepts and the principles and some definitions. And then Amy will take over and then I'll come back towards the end to wrap up the session. So we wanted to start out by sharing a definition about community-based programming. And we looked at several different sources, and actually there is quite a bit of concurrence around this. So we happen to have chosen this, which is a UK-based definition. But like I said, it is something that reoccurs in the literature through various sources. Community-based programming is synonymous to often use of participatory methods where community members themselves are actively involved in planning the design, the delivery, and evaluation of services. And, you know, the approach to community-based programming strives to address some of the power differentials that may exist between service providers and communities. In other words, to really kind of try to level the playing field. And it also aims to promote health and well-being and reduce inequities at the community level. So this kind of three-part definition is something that really gives rise to some of the key concepts and principles, which we'll talk about next. Next slide, please. If you can move on to slide 11. So some of the three main concepts that hopefully kind of become apparent to you in that definition and through this discussion today are community, collaboration, and positive change. Those are the kind of the main concepts. And related to these concepts, we have identified six guiding principles. Community, as in, it's really important as a principle to know your community really well, to reflect your communities in the work that you do, and to respect them and recognize and reciprocate. And we'll go through each of these in the next few slides. Targeted universalism and ethical treatment of communities. Those are the six principles that correspond to these concepts. So we'll go through these one by one. Next slide, please. So just to pause here, and we'll do a poll. In answering this question, when you think about community, what is it that you think about? And I'm going to ask for the poll to be administered, and there are some choices there for you to select.
I didn't have chance to do it.
My apologies. There was a technical error. We will repeat it in a moment.
Oh, thank you. Yeah, it was so fast. I say, I start reading and disappear.
And I'm going to apologize. I do have a dog in the background who is supposed to be controlled, but I will apologize in advance if he gets excited. He gets excited very easily. Okay. So thank you. Lots of people answering the poll. When you think about community, what is it that you think about? What are some of the attributes that you think about? Okay, so maybe Adele, we can end now. So it's interesting, it looks, and perhaps not surprising, that amongst you, many of you, or the majority of you, think in terms of the ethno-racial identity of the community that you might be working with or that you're connected to. Gender comes up high too, in terms of we know that many services sometimes are women specific or gender specific. So that seems to be up high. And also immigration status. Okay. So thank you. If we can move on. So as you have shared, community is generally, we think about it in terms of groups of people who share some type of commonality. Geography, which interestingly didn't really come up in the poll, but interest, having a common interest, having a common identity, whether it's ethno-racial, gender, sometimes employment status, experience, or a common or shared problem or issue. And one of the things that's really important for us to note, and again, this may feel obvious, but it's important to emphasize this, that when we think in terms of communities, there are, of course, differences within communities, that communities are never, homogeneous and on all fronts. And so, if you're thinking of a community as a neighborhood that shares a common geography, within that community, there will be some common experiences, but there will be many other differences in terms of socioeconomic status, type of family, race, type of housing. And so these differences can really affect how people experience the community and in this case, the neighborhood, and how they then in turn, think about themselves in terms of their role, in terms of their involvement. Next slide, please. And this, slide speaks about the, it uses the metaphor of a jigsaw. If we think in terms of communities and ourselves, even at an individual level, when we think about knowing and describing our community, it isn't so straightforward. It is quite complex because each community and each individual within the community really has multiple identities. And the intersectionality that exists between the different identities is really important to acknowledge. And so in this jigsaw puzzle, if you think in terms of the puzzle, which is, say, there is your biological sex, but then there is maybe your gender identity, which is different, your sexual orientation, your economic status, your life experience, your life story, your age, all these are different dimensions to communities that really speak to the different experiences. And, a couple of things that we noted in this slide, for instance, is that immigration status is not reflected. And we know that for most of you, that is going to be really important in terms of the settlement period or how recently the community members have arrived in Ontario or in Canada will, be a factor in terms of their experience of being here. Next slide, please. We thought that we would include this definition of what are racialized communities. And there are several different, definitions available. But generally, we do want to just acknowledge that in our current context in Canada, racialized groups are referred to those as people of color. So we won't spend too much time here, but this is a definition that we've made available here because racialization is really a social and a political process. The term gets used quite frequently nowadays in terms of referring to people of color. So continuing with the concepts and the principles, we've talked about the community in terms of the different ways of knowing the community, different identities, all the different layers and the intersectionality. So the next concept we want to touch on is collaboration. And here, when we think in terms of collaboration with the communities, we want to talk about the principles of being reflective of your community, respecting and recognizing and reciprocating. So if I can get the next slide up. In terms of collaboration at the community level, in community-based programming, what is really felt to be important is that there is active involvement of community members in all aspects of programming. So everything from assessing needs, planning the design and delivery of programs, as well as evaluation of the program or service. And that this collaboration is done through a participatory approach and really paying attention to addressing the power differentials that may exist. And some of the barriers that may exist for people to prevent them from really being at the same level as people who are in the role of leadership and service providers. So next slide, please. So when you think in terms of participatory approaches and in your community and the diversity of members within the communities, keeping in mind that the identities that we talked about, the intersectionality, when you think in terms of participation, and it may be helpful to think about some of the community members that may be the most marginalized, what are some of the barriers that you think would experience that would prevent them from participating and being at a level playing field? And what supports would they need? So I believe we have a poll here. Adil? We have some choices for you to select from in terms of the types of barriers. And again, this is not an exhaustive list. It's some of the common ones that we thought about. And feel free to choose more than one barrier, because there may be more than one thing that's in the way of people participating. Okay. So I'm seeing about 46 people participating. That's, I think, roughly a little bit more than half. Or maybe I'm misreading this. Adele, can we close the poll now, please? So these are the results. I see that majority of you are really saying like all of the barriers are relevant, you know, lack of understanding of how systems work seem to be really high up there, and that, you know, in our experience is very, very understandable, very reasonable. Especially when you think in terms of communities who are newly arrived and newly settling. Amy and I have experience working with communities who've been settled for quite some time here, or who, are not immigrants. And even they have difficulty understanding how systems work. So that's a very reasonable barrier, and it has obviously implications in how you think about collaboration with the community and the steps that you will take to make sure that people are actually able to participate in as reasonable way as possible. Okay, thank you, Adele. So when we think in terms of the principles of collaboration, this is more of a kind of a recap. When we talk about reflecting your communities, it's really important that people that you connect with, that you bring together, that you are making sure that you are thinking about all the diverse segments that are present within your communities, and that you're involving them in decisions, so that the process, the collaborative process, is as truly reflective of your communities and the different elements or different segments of the communities that exist within that. So, you know, most communities are, you know, 50% at least women or more. You need to make sure that, you know, more than 50% of your participants that you are bringing together are in fact women, that it's not a process that is dominated mostly by men being present. And if a certain group is not able to be present, then you need to ask the question why and what are the barriers, and you need to have another process in place to allow those missing segments of the community to be involved. Respecting your communities. So one of the things that is very frustrating for communities is they are often the target of being consulted with, and then, you know, there's a big vacuum and they don't know what happened with the input that they gave, because the process of involving them was more like a one-off process. And that's really important to kind of be aware of, to not get into that type of mistake, because you're really going to leave a bad taste, if you will, in with communities, because they do, out of sheer respect, need updates, need input in terms of what it is that's happened with their input that they provided. And again, we've talked about, you know, finding ways to facilitate their participation. So we'll talk a little bit more about that when we go through the specific examples. But if you need to have the process happen in a specific location where people find it easier to participate, if you need to have translators there or cultural interpreters, if you need to, you know, have things done in bite sizes so that, you know, it's not a fully jam-packed agenda, that you're, you know, doing it in several steps so that people are able to understand, digest, ask questions. So again, these are basic kinds of things around respect, but sometimes, you know, in the interest of trying to be efficient, we kind of go through things really fast. And it's really important to contribute back to the community through acknowledging their input and valuing their input. So, you know, reciprocating, like providing some honoraria, but also, you know, food is, you know, a meal of often is a very important way of acknowledging people's contribution and thanking them. You know, investing in the community by providing some training, some skills development. And most importantly, in terms of reciprocating and recognizing, communities are often, when they give input, they are looking for action. They are looking for a response to the needs that they've talked about. So, you know, making sure that you're committed to follow through with that and communicating to them about what is happening, what's coming up next, and trying to be as open and transparent and honest about that. So next slide, please. The third concept here is around positive change. So community-based programming really, in the definition, there was that notion of promoting health and well-being and reducing inequities. So that is all about bringing about change, desired change that is being sought out. And the principles here are connected to this are the notion of targeted universalism. And this is a phrase that a term that is not as familiar to people. So we'll talk a little bit more about that and ethical treatment of communities. So we'll go to the next slide. And so before we get into some of the specifics around those principles, maybe we can pause here. And here's another poll. So you've come to this workshop with some ideas about changes that you want to work towards in response to needs in the community. So what are some of those positive changes? And here's a poll that you can select from. Again, you may want to select more than one if it's relevant for you. Go ahead. Okay. Adele, maybe we can share the results now. Thank you. Again, it's not surprising, in terms of what you see here. A lot of you have issues of employment, especially employment in areas of their chosen occupations, chosen careers. Health, physical health, mental health, those are high up there. And really working towards a sense of belonging in this, in the province, in the country. Okay, thank you. So when we think in terms of positive changes, again, just to recap what many of the OCASI members and other organizations may be working towards and, that they're currently funded for or looking to getting funding for, again, in the area of promoting health and well-being, issues of what we think about as social determinants of health, whether it's basic needs like housing, food, social support, access to appropriate and timely healthcare, preventative practices and self-care, accelerating settlement, right? That sense of belonging by becoming economically active, becoming more proficient with the official languages, whether it's French or English. Next slide, please. Other examples could be facilitating integration through civic participation, work that you might do at the host community level in terms of creating a more welcoming and inclusive environment for newcomers, timely access to information, and reducing inequities by really thinking about who are the most vulnerable and reaching and being effective with the most vulnerable in your communities. Making sure that they are getting the right types of supports and interventions to achieve the desired outcomes and overcoming barriers in participating or accessing services. So these could be various positive change examples that you might be working on in your organizations or in your proposal that you might be working on for the future. Next slide. So when we think about targeted universalism as a principle, basically what that is about is that you are developing strategies that are going to address the needs of the most marginalized. And by doing so, you actually achieve a universal goal that is of benefit to the broader community, okay? So, so if we take an example of people with disabilities in your community, and something that, you know, you might develop with them in mind, chances are that the supports that are put in place are actually going to be valuable for other groups in the community as well. Sometimes, you know, seniors, while they may not have disabilities at present, they are going to at some point. People with limited mobility issues, temporary injuries, for instance, that they might incur. So you can see that how when you think about somebody who is most marginalized, you develop something for them, it actually has a more positive benefit for other groups as well in the community. So that's the notion of targeted universalism. And when you think about changes, think about that as an important principle. Sometimes it's too tempting to think about people who it's easiest to serve. And, you know, there's that English phrase of low-hanging fruit. While that may be, you know, important or helpful to some degree, it really does not address the inequities that may exist in your communities and that you really need to be thinking about in terms of the most vulnerable, the most marginalized in your communities. The ethical considerations is that the changes that you're working towards, you need to be thinking about, you know, is there any potential harm? Sometimes a change that might appear positive on the surface may actually have a more subtle or it may be more mid to long-term harm. So you need to think in terms of, you know, from an ethical point of view, and the harm may also be in terms of not just to the individual, but also in terms of the community. So it could be how the community gets perceived by others. And in this instance, with thinking about ethical considerations, it's really important to focus beyond the individual and look at some of the broader structural challenges or issues that might be pertinent and especially around stigma and discrimination that might come about as a result of some change that initially you might think is positive, but in fact it results in a negative consequence like that. So thank you. Next slide. So now you're going to get a chance to have a break from listening to my voice because Amy's going to take over and she's going to focus on preparing to develop your program concept for funders with some detailed information and examples.
Thank you, Zubeida. Can I have the next slide, please? So yeah, like if you, I'm sure, many of you have read the RFP that just issued by IRCC, and IRCC was very specific that there are certain core principles that they would like you to consider and incorporate in your funding proposals. And so what we are doing is actually incorporate these principles into the program development process. So that by following, hopefully, you know, following through this program development cycle, you are also reflecting the core principles that IRCC are trying to highlight in the funding program. The four areas that they want you to look at is client-centeredness, responsiveness to needs, outcome-driven, and effective use of resources. Of course, we all understand what client-centeredness means. It's really that you have the core, you have the best interest of the client at your heart, in your design, in everything that you do. So that is going to be the crux of the whole program design, the whole program development. And in fact, and it's not just the design, it is also the implementation, it is also the evaluation. So it is the core that drives the whole process. And if you look at client-centeredness, in fact, the funder also talk about those that are marginalized, those that are vulnerable, those that are that face additional barriers. So that concept, we believe, aligned with what we said around targeted universalism. And so we need to, that understanding of client-centeredness, we need to develop programs that are responsive to their needs. And they are also highlighting that it just not only the needs of the individuals, but the needs of the society, because of course IRCC and other funders have a higher level of objective that they would like to see that effective and true integration of newcomers would of course advance the society and facilitate that overall settlement process as a whole and advance collective good of Canada. And that when we are doing the design, we also look at the outcome. And as Zubeida said, the key concept is that you always have the benefits that you are trying to achieve in mind. So it's always the outcome driven. And again, what we're trying to highlight is not just the individual, but also the social benefits that we are trying to achieve here. And the last, but definitely not least in the mind, and also, of course, for societal good, we are looking at the ensuring of the effective use of our resources, not only financially, but also leveraging partnership, leveraging the volunteer resources and the community as a whole in terms of what communities can offer and help contribute to this process. So next slide, please. So how you can see that we have incorporated the funders, four areas, the principles into, we call it the program development cycle, the planning, implementation, and evaluation, and client-centeredness basically covers it's an encompassing thing that covers and drives the whole cycle. Responsiveness and outcome driven, particularly are highlighted in the planning process. And of course, effectiveness of resources actually also tied to the planning as well as the implementation and outcomes and how you evaluate and the ongoing improvement of your program has to be incorporated throughout this process. So if we look at the next slide, please. So we understand that you are at different stage as an organization. So we'd like to get to know you a little bit better, even though we're not really communicating, we can't see you well, but hopefully getting to know you better, and also from the questions that you're going to ask later, that we'll be able to respond to your needs more appropriately. So if we're going to pull out that poll, we're going to ask you, you know, the type of organization or describe the group that you are with. So Adele, can you pull up that poll, please? Some of you are already answering. So what position you are in the organization? Are you a board member? Are you a manager, coordinator, a volunteer? So I can see today that you're answering, but I've only seen three people who have answered so far. So please.
My apologies. I stopped it because I was showing the wrong poll. Would you like me to relaunch this
we can stick with this, Adele. It's okay. Let's stick with this. The first question we're asking you is your position in the organization. Thank you. Just to get to know you. Or yes. Wow. Okay, so there are 65 of you. I'm seeing 42 answers. Some of you may be on a device that's hard to respond to a poll. Understand that. That's okay. I'm just gonna give you a few more seconds, maybe 10 more seconds. We're gonna close this. Okay, let's close this and let's see. So majority of you are in the management position and coordinating role. There are some board members here and there are others too, I'm sure, community members and volunteers. So thank you very much. And in fact, we do have a next poll, which we're gonna ask you is about the group that you are with. Describe the group. Are you recently arrived, community, early settlement, or you already have a program idea that you already have a program idea developed by the community leaders, but you haven't tested it yet. But actually, some of you had already done some pilot testing or had already some experience with program strategy, and you just need to sort of revise it or to tweak your piloted program. So again, please respond which phrase or which statement will best describe the group that you are in right now. I see again, 30 people have answered out of 67. Maybe none of these describe the group. But again, if you take a few minutes, I'm going to give you 5 more seconds, then we can close the poll. Okay, thank you. So I can see that some of you actually have already some experiences and had a chance to pilot, which is good. Some have already developed some ideas, haven't tested it yet, and then some are at an earlier stage. So it's a pretty pretty equal split. So thank you very much for letting us get to know you, what stage you're in right now. So if we move to the next slide, please. So we're gonna talk about the planning cycle that we kept referring to. And we're gonna use this like who, what, why, when, where, and how, and to guide this, because I find that those by raising those questions, it's much easier for you to understand that, and much easier even for us to talk about these concepts. First of all, the who, of course, right? Define the target groups and what communities are you really working with? And then after defining, we're gonna talk about the process, the forming with the community members, with other members that would contribute to that process, a planning committee and a working group. We're gonna talk about how to conduct a needs assessment. We are going to also talk about then how do you develop goals and decide outcomes, which we mentioned before, and also then talk about the develop method and intervention. So the who are the first two, and then we're gonna talk about the why, and then the needs assessment, and then we're gonna talk about the how, which pertain to the goals as well as methodology. So let's start with the who. Next slide, please. So we need to, first of all, really get to know the communities that you are intending to target, right? So and by that, creating that profile, we are talking about pretty in-depth, you know, knowledge. That means you really need to get to know their age, their income, the gender identities, education, health outcomes, and all that. And also, of course, the racial racial diversity, so that you then, because all these like understanding of the various dimensions, as Zubeida said, each one of us define ourselves in multiple way, in intersectional way. And if our needs have to be met, we need to know who we are serving, how they define themselves, and what are the key dimensions that we need to look at. And in particular, as we said, with all these data, we need to find out the disadvantages and the marginalization that the communities are experiencing. Next slide, please. So where do you get the data then? You know, that how we mentioned the, all the dimensions
on that the wrong slide. You're on the wrong slide.
Oh,
yeah. Okay.
Yeah, sorry. Good. Thank you. So where do you get these data in terms of the demographics, right? The gender identity, racial composition, you know, and income and all that. Where do you get them? You can get them from Stats Canada. You can get them from research, policy research, such as the Canadian Council of Social Development or Canadian Council of Policy Alternatives. There are also city of, if you're from the city, actually the City of Toronto has marvelous ward profiles, neighborhood profiles on their website that can you can easily go to and look at the various ward down to the specific ward that you are working with, so neighborhood and all that. And also, of course, data can be obtained by yourself. In your own, the data that you receive from your clients, from your own community surveys and needs assessment that are done by your organization or by others. Basically, you really have to have a good understanding the demographics, the needs, and the profile of the community. And if you look at the next slide, we do have an example here. This is actually this case study that we are going to talk about, all ties to the settlement needs of the internationally educated nurses. So an agency, a settlement agency, noticed that there's a large number of their clients who are internationally educated nurses, and these clients are facing tremendous barriers, which are not unknown, you know, it's been well reported, well, you know, discussed, and in fact, advocacy groups have talked about that for decades. So, and including OCASI has been raising these issues. So the settlement workers gathered from the clients a preliminary list of the challenges. So they know who they are, where they are from, usually, and then usually still true, majority of them are women, majority of them are women with families, many of them with young children, many of them are in jobs that are precarious, low-paying jobs, service industry, and many of them don't speak English well, many of them are not familiar with the licensing process, their education has not been recognized, and then when they prepare for the exam, they simply don't have the time and financial resources to do that. And the, of course, as I said, that lack of English proficiency is a major challenge. So you gather, you know, this profile, right? These demographics from the basics in terms of their demographic to, of course, a bit of their needs. And before you go into the in-depth needs assessment. Next slide, please. So before we do the needs assessment, who do we have to help us do the work, help us brainstorm, help us plan, help us design? Who do we do that? And so it's important to consider that informing a planning committee and a working group. So next slide, we talk about then who should be part of this planning committee and working group. Of course, you need, first of all, is the communities that you have in your targeted community. So the IENs have to be there. But who else? Like, you need to have people who have experiences differently, who have different expertise, different knowledge within your organization and also outside of your organization. The people with financial experience, with program development, program implementation experience, and also, of course, hopefully, you know, in connections to the communities that you are trying to target. And so you need to form this group, thinking of the expertise, thinking of the skills, thinking of the knowledge, and as we said, respect the communities that you are trying to embrace. And here, when you talk about respect, you need to make sure that you have provisions for support, financial incentives, even basic TTC tokens, translation, accessible language communications, so that their contributions are acknowledged and recognized. And many organizations, if possible, we do encourage you to see if honorarium can be provided to the particular target groups that you're working with. So if you move to the next slide, we continue with that case example of the IEN. So a working group was formed. So you look at internally, we are settlement agencies. Who else do we need on this working group? We probably need some healthcare providers who are the employers who have been hiring and who probably have challenges hiring nurses into their sector. And so we reach out to them. And then we also look at one key element. We need the Ontario College of Nurses, which is the regulatory body that is licensing the registered nurses, because they have the knowledge, they are the gatekeeper, but they also hold the keys to opening the doors for these nurses. And also they have the knowledge of understanding what the barriers are, or trying to, so that you know where the nurses are failing in their licensing process. So, and of course you need internationally educated nurses on the working group in the committee, so that you have that lived experiences. So we move to the next slide, please. So the next slide is conducting a needs assessment. So move to the next slide. Let's talk about needs assessment. So needs assessment will answer the questions. What are the primary issues and concerns? What is the root of the problem? What are the varied experiences within the target communities? And of course, how are their lives being impacted, right? What are they, how are they coping at the present? And then where do they go for support at this time? And what is their experience? And what are the specific barriers that they are encountering right now? And so when you do needs assessment, you really have to find the answers for each of these questions and some more. And these are just a preliminary draft. There may be many others that you want to develop before you conduct that needs assessment. So if we look at, turn to the next slide, is to look at them. How do we gather that information? So you can look at reports being done, any needs assessment again done by you. And don't forget, you already have rich sources of data because of your root of your connections with the communities, right? Because you already have communities member who can share with you their lived experiences. So the issue is, how do you get that from them, right? So so the needs assessment is readily available sometimes, right? And if not, then you need to, of course, look at how do you gather that, and and how do you even reach out and do that needs assessment? And you probably have to come up with a plan and some questions, and you need to test them out with your committee and your working group, because on your committee will be people probably with some expertise with these areas, as well as people with lived experiences, such as the IENs, who can tell, oh yeah, this questions make sense or this questions do not make sense. And again, the key thing is that ethically driven process, right? The needs assessment has to be done in an ethical manner. And okay, again, driven by respect of the communities. Then of course, we need to do the outreach, right? You can conduct interviews one-on-one, you can do focus groups. Again, respect the communities mean that we need to reduce the barrier for them to truly share their stories, share their experiences with you. So you can do it sometimes with peers, cultural brokers, translators, interpreters. Sometimes, you do it virtually, if people have access to that. If not, then has to be done in person. You, again, the key principles of doing all that is respect and reduce barriers. And if you look at the next slide, we also talk about, other ways of collecting information. There are social media now is so widely used, even amongst newcomers, because my experience with newcomers, some of them are more savvy than me. Of course, those with resources, I'm not suggesting that those without resources and don't even have phones would not be able to do that, but some with that access and resources are quite tech savvy. And then there are also existing platforms and communities where they gather, places of worship, community centers, and all that, where you can reach them. And you also can reach key informants who are leaders, who are agencies that have an history of or experiences and also the connections with the communities. So the key thing is be realistic, right? That given the limited resources you have, you need to be mindful and don't, I know that it would be impossible for any of us to conduct extensive needs assessment study like the academic institutions funded by the government. We don't have that, unfortunately. So we need to be mindful and balance that with our the need to find out with the resources that we have. And so sometimes is that you would do snapshots, right? Instead of an in-depth needs assessment. And then in answering and in adding the questions, you also may also want to make sure that you talk about the unmet needs, right? That the clients are facing right now. And you also talk, and you can also gather from your own client records, right? The intake forms to understand, for example, the settlement agencies, they actually have intake forms, right? That gather the data and from that and talk to your key informants, could be your counselors, could be your settlement workers who are already on the ground, in the field, in the trenches, we call, with that familiarity. So focus groups and all that. So all these are ways for you to gather information. And there are also other ways. The next slide talks about other organizations that are already providing that. So actually I have talked. So if you move to the next slide, So other organizations that are already providing related services in the field. So tap into the group, tap into the working group that you form to learn from them, to do that outreach, to identify the various sources. The next slide continues. So in the gathering of the information, you need to explore what specifically are these organizations that are already having the services for the community groups. What are they doing? What are they not doing? Who are they serving and who are they not serving? Because we all know that even within the diverse target groups, not everybody is serving everybody within the target groups. So you need to find out more. And what is their current reach? And what are the concerns that they have about that, right? And how effective they are. And so you need to find out from the service providers, but also you need to find out from the communities, what are their feedback about these services from these organizations? And what are the challenges that they that the organizations are facing when they are and they are providing services to the target group, the lessons that they learn. But you also learn from the target groups, the communities that you work with, the challenges that they face from working with these existing providers. So, and of course, is there an opportunity to collaborate? Are there any other research studies that are available about the target communities that you can tap into? So we've looked at the next slide. So needs assessment basically is to then gather all that data, and you've got all the data that you have, then you do a gap analysis. And this gap analysis will then help you identify, you know, the, so you have, you know, the input is the user of the program and the services, the community needs. The community needs are not only of the current members that are using the services, but future users and the services that are currently provided and additional services that are that should be provided. So this gap analysis should have all these data with you, and then you look at where are the missing pieces, where are the pieces that you think can enhance the well-being of the communities. So if we turn to the next slide, the case example. So the working group did conduct a needs assessment and data gathering. So by how do they do that? They conducted key informants interviews with employers, with regulatory bodies, with education institutions, because community colleges as well as universities do offer courses for IENs. They also talk to professional nursing associations such as RNAO, such as the unions, right? The ONA and as I mentioned, the employers and settlement and employment agencies that are serving not only IENs, but other internationally educated healthcare professionals, so that to understand the barriers, the challenges, and the commonalities of experiences across. So these key informant studies and group focus discussions are critical for you to gather. And then the next slide talks about, so with the data from the various the interviews and focus groups, then they also obtained data specifically from the College of Nurses. And specifically the data includes the understanding of that whole licensing process, the eligibility criteria, and specifically from the College of Nurses, the barriers experienced by IENs. What are the numbers of IENs that are writing the exams annually? What's the pass rate of the IENs passing the exam or failing the exam? How many of them are locally trained, the nurses that write the exams? What's their pass rate so that you have a comparison? And what are how many of the IENs actually do submit an applications to the college? And many of them actually do not follow up with the writing the exam. So you have a sense of a more comprehensive understanding of the IENs and where they are at in the licensing process. So the data is critical. Evidence, numbers is critical. From the point where you gather the data of the populations, the demographics, to the needs assessment, wherever you it's possible for you to get numbers, you know, to tell your stories later for your funding applications, it is very, very important. Data, I cannot highlight how important numbers are. So next slide. So now we are looking at then develop the goals and the outcomes and develop the methods and methodology. So we are now into that sort of like program design and program planning. So next slide, please. So now we are answering the how, where, and where, okay? The designing, the program, and the specific intervention. So now, first of all, again, we need to organize this design session, not just session, but sessions, right? So you have your working group, you have your committee with the various lived experience, expertise and knowledge and information and all that. But you probably also didn't look at who or who else should be involved. When you are gathering the needs assessment, you also identify the potential partners and players in the field already. So reach out to them, because they may be also interested in the partnership and collaboration. And in fact, IRCC specifically highlight that piece around partnership and collaboration in that funding proposal. And specifically, they want you to consider that exploration, that outreach, right? So then with all the group gathered together, with the individuals, with the members, all that, then the question is, so what is the positive change, the outcomes that you want to achieve, the desired outcomes in the short term, the medium term, and the long term? And what would you know if those outcomes have been achieved? And here we are, again, matrix, measurements, indicators, numbers, you know. Of course, it's not just numbers. Qualitative data stories are important, but, you know, as you know, IRCC, other funders are always looking for numbers, so they can tell a good stories in terms of the impact of their funding. So what are the individual and systemic change that you want to affect? And if you look at the next slide, we continue on to look at the how, when, and where. So we look at then all these, right? So you have the outcomes in mind, okay? You have the data, you have the indicators. So it's like strategic planning, right? So you have the priorities, you have the objectives, you have the 3 years outcomes that you want to achieve. So now, so how do you then achieve that? What needs to be done? What needs to be delivered to make that change? What are the options? What are the preferred options and why? And that's why it is so important when you gather the information to know what has worked and what hasn't worked, and to have the people with lived experiences at the table to tell you what has worked and what hasn't worked, right? So that evidence and that research and that organization and individual experiences are therefore so important, right? And so then you also, of course, talk about the resources required once you have the interventions decided. It's like an action planning, right? So you have the action plan, you then look at the resources, including volunteerism, including staffing, equipment, facilities, and all that, and gather all the players. So when you have that program in mind, then you also have a better idea who else are missing at the table, who else can we reach out to so that our program can be truly effective. And think outside the box, because many times you're going to find out, in fact, there are nothing out there, right? Because the targeted communities that you're working with have been ignored, or the specific issues that you are trying to address have been overlooked and nobody has really dealt with them. Think outside the box. Think of, you know, dream and dream big, and then bring it down to how can I realize that in a programmatic level. So if we go to the next slide, then we again share the case examples of the IENs. Here we are. So based on the data, based on the needs assessment, based on the brainstorming and all the program planning intervention, we did look at how many programs are there right now out there and what worked and what hasn't worked. So at the end, the program decided on was to, the outcomes was to help the IENs achieve success in the licensing exam. So current at the time, the registered nurses, the internationally educated nurses were failing left, right, and center. They were failing at like 66%. That means overwhelming majority were failing. So instead of 66% fail, we were aiming at increasing that to 75%. And we also want to help the IN secure employment. So the program that we design at the end, if you look at the next slide, would include provide timely and accurate information as early as possible, including actually prior landing information, and assist them in the credential evaluation, which is a major barrier, as we all know. And to orientate, two things that we've identified particular is that IENs don't know the nursing culture in Ontario. We believe that all of them should have that familiarity, and all of them should also go through an assessment so that they can identify their strength and areas where they need improvement, so that their training, so that their course development would be catering to those areas that need to that need a bit strengthening, so that they are more prepared for the licensing exam. We also develop nursing specific language training program because we understand language proficiency is a barrier. So, and when we are doing all that, we all know that IENs, as we mentioned, when we did our needs assessment, many of them are in low-paying jobs. They don't have the money to go to colleges. They don't have the money. So how do we make sure that they have bursaries, they have financial support while they are going through this program, including childcare, including, you know, financial support for the family. So that actually concludes my part. I know that I've gone through that quite quickly, but hopefully in the questions that you're going to share, we'll be able to respond better next time. Thank you. I'm going to turn to Zubeida.
Thanks, Amy. So just to sum up then, what's really important as you are working on your proposal, and you know, we've kind of gone over a lot of information, probably enough information to pack into a 12-week, one semester long course at least. But you know, it's really important to document all the stages of your process, because you need to make sure that you are on firm ground when you are questioned as to how you came up with the proposal or the needs that you've identified. And, you know, we've talked about collaborating with the working group and making sure that, you know, keeping in mind what many of you have identified as a barrier in terms of people not knowing how the system works, it's really important to think about doing this work in bite sizes so that, you know, it's not overwhelming, that people are engaged, that they don't get lost in the process, and that you truly do end up with a program proposal that has come from the community. of course, the funder's proposal template is a very important guide for you to also consider. So next slide, please. So in summary, we would you know, say that investing the required time and resources for planning a community-based program is really a challenge. Most of us don't have that kind of time, or we don't invest that kind of time. And of course, when you involve people, when you use a participatory approach, that definitely takes time, especially if you're really trying to be genuine and true and respectful to the barriers that people experience and address those barriers as you're going through the process. And unfortunately, most times what tends to happen is that funders give a relatively short time frame for proposals to be developed and submitted. So next slide, please. So it's really, you know, instead of kind of scrambling at the last minute to pull together a proposal. And what ends up happening, of course, is that deadline is looming and you end up, you know, just a couple of people or one or two people end up working on the proposal and submitting it, which really is not what you want to end up doing. So our advice to you would be, you know, of course, you have to try your best. What we've portrayed here is an ideal process, but also recognize that you don't have to wait for a call for proposals to be, you know, working in this way and putting together a solid proposal that is based in data and evidence and involvement of various segments of your community, but also all the potential partners and so on. Of course, this requires anticipation and deliberateness and discipline in terms of the planning process. You know, one thought that we would, I think, leave you with is that, you know, if you are not successful in getting the funding, don't just put this aside and forget about it. It's actually a very good reason to keep going and to make sure that you're actually putting in taking the various steps to refine the work and ensuring that the proposal is really grounded in the community. So next slide, please. In summary then, the very last slide, I believe, is really the authenticity of your relationship with the community is really critical. And when you think in terms of community-based programming, active listening, being transparent, providing for resources to facilitate participation, commitment to reflecting and revising the work as you go along, as you listen to the community, remuneration and compensation. You see all the principles that we've talked about are conveyed in here, and being realistic about your expectations and trying to not overcommit and really recognize what your own limitations are, your own organization's limitations. And people are generally very reasonable. They know that, you know, you have to aim high, but you may not necessarily get everything that you ask for. So I think this is where we will conclude. Over to you, Adil.
Thank you, Zubeida. Thank you, Amy, for this exceptional workshop today. I would like to remind our participants that this today is half the workshop. Next week will be the follow-up. Everything you see today, the presentations are available on the project site. I'll be sending an email with those materials link. Please send us your questions, whether by email, whether on Slido, and we will be addressing those questions on how to relate what we've learned here today with the proposal writing application. I will also be posting in the chat. Oh, thank you, Jeffrey. They put my email in the chat if you'd like to send us send your questions. I will also be posting the evaluation surveys. It's a short survey. It will really be helpful for us at OCASI to know what you thought about today's workshop. Is there anything you'd like to see improved or work upon? So please don't hesitate to share your thoughts. And I will also be sharing by email the Slido link also, but feel free to send your questions by email. That's completely okay. So our next follow-up will be November 30 at 12 to 1, as well as we are launching another proposal writing workshop that will be focusing specifically on the IRCC CFP. It will be December 4, and the follow-up session will, December 21st, which will also be a Thursday. It will be a two-hour workshop to focus on the guidelines. And we will also have a follow-up session on January 4 regarding questions and answers for that. And I will be sending you the call to register late this week or early next week. Next slide, please. In the meantime, I would like to remind everyone that our third workshop of this series will be focusing on financial management for small Black-led and racialized organizations with Roger Remkinson, who's a financial and HR specialist. Thank you, everyone, for today. And thank you again for Zubeida and Amy, our amazing interpreters, and the amazing OCASI team who've supported today in the background with the technicalities. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Merci, au revoir.
Au revoir.
See.